group's been the Living Brothers, Charlie and I.
We just gotta deal with it for a little bit.
We're doing one of their songs next called Love. Darling, I'm all alone in our little mountain home. It's empty, cold, and loveless now inside. For they say our childish vows lasted only one short year. That had gone away to be another's bride. You will never know the pain that I felt the day you left. Should you ever wed again, let me wish you love and from our sorrows we must turn, and be able to forget sad memories. Let me wish you love and wealth, may you take no care of the steps, while a broken heart will last eternally. You will never know the pain that I felt the day you left.
What he wanted us to do, he said, "Tone it down a little bit, boys. I want you to come on and be really subdued." How are we doing? I'd rather be in some dark hour where the sun don't ever shine than to be all alone just knowing that you're gone. It would cause me to lose my mind. So freight train, blow your whistle, carry me farther on down the track. I'm leaving today, I'm going to say I'm leaving, but I ain't coming back. I'd rather be in some dark hollow where the sun don't ever shine than to be all alone in some big city in a small room with you on my mind. So blow your whistle, freight train, carry me farther on down the track. I'm leaving today, I'm going to say I'm leaving, but I ain't coming back. I'm leaving today, I'm going to say I'm leaving, but I ain't coming back.
Thank you.
said about my heart. Then I would have forgotten you since we've been apart. You said, of course, my lips to kiss you when we said goodbye. You even said I forced the tears that came into my eyes. Picture in your mind, I'm never all alone. You see me with another girl, just like I've been with you. But from the way I sleep at night, I only wish you knew. Said if I was as good as Carroll Best, I wouldn't even speak to myself. He was truly a genius. They still don't appreciate what all he's done.
Very recorded, honey.
There's very few people who really attempted to play his style. His grandson's playing. We had a friend over at Fletcher, North Carolina, Flay Park, who can play some of Carroll's style, and it's very intricate. And he's a genius right up there with Earl Scruggs and Don Reno, the other masters of the five-string banjo. We're gonna do another Luther Brothers team for you. One called "Are You Afraid to Die?"
Are you a stranger to God? Carried away with your pride. Tell me, sinner. Did you ever stop to think? Are you afraid to die? Are you afraid? Are you unsafe? Are you afraid to die? Are you too wicked to cry?
Verses 2, this is.
Let's pair you the other 58 tonight.
sun flowed down the sky marina. Frost is where the flowers have been, but the heart beats on as warmly now as when the summer sun was nigh. Oh, the sun can never sink so low to be down in affection's cloudless sky. Last I held that hand in mine and felt the pulse beat fast, Lorena, though mine beat faster far than thine. 100 months 'twas when I remained, when up that hilly slope we climbed to watch the dying of the day and hear those distant church bells chime.
Thank you. I don't think any bluegrass session would be complete if we didn't sing a song about being in jail. Dad and Mom, two of them. And the other thing is they have a girl that left them, or they've got one they wish for you. You know, so. We'll do the prison song for you now. It's one called Shackles and Chains.
On a long and lonesome journey I'm going, so darling, please don't you cry. For in shackles and chains they're gonna take me to prison to stay till I die. And every night through the bars, as I gaze at the stars and dream of your kisses in vain, piece of stone I will use for my pillow while I'm sleeping in shackles and chains. Put your arms through these bars once, my darling. Let me kiss those sweet lips I love best. For in sadness you're my consolation, and in sorrow my haven of rest. And every night through the bars, as I gaze at the stars and dream of your kisses in vain, a piece of stone I will use for my pillow while I'm sleeping. If your heart
know that my poor soul will say that living this world in a house of gold and deny my God and lose my soul. That living this world in a house of gold and deny my God and lose my soul. We really appreciate y'all being here tonight. We understand y'all had other options of where you could be, and we appreciate you coming and being with us and being part of this tribute to a truly magnificent man. We're going to close out now with one that's another Lutheran Brothers tune. It's one called Satan's Jewel Crown. If I were a king and a ruler of nations with diamonds and jewels profound, well, I'd rather know that I had salvation than to know my reward would be Satan's jewel crown, Satan's jewel crown. I've worn it so long, but God for my soul has reached down. His love set me free. He made me his own, and he helped me cast off Satan's jewel crown. Oh, this life that I live, so sinful and evil, drinking and running around, all the things that I do for the love of the devil, I know my reward will be Satan's jewel crown. Satan's jewel crown. I've worn it so long, but God for my soul has reached out. He made me his own, and he helped me cast off Satan's jewel crown, and he helped me cast off Satan's jewel crown.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Ted mentioned I grew up playing music with my dad, grew up here in Haywood County, learned from some of the great local families and musicians that Laura and others have mentioned. One of the people that I did get to meet and hear play, couldn't keep up with him though, was Carroll West. I grew up playing clawhammer style. That's the style I learned at home, and it's what I really wanted to play. At the time, though, bluegrass three-finger style was all the rage, and that's mostly what people wanted to hear was that three-finger style, which, you know, when I was young, I kind of chafed at that a little bit. You know, I wanted to play clawhammer, but I was familiar with clawhammer style, I was familiar with the scrug style, and I was also familiar with a more kind of a two-finger style that a lot of the old-timers played. So I knew those different styles, and everybody that I heard play pretty much was in one of those three categories. And I was probably about 10 years old or thereabouts. My dad said, well, we're going to go hear this banjo player. And he took me to a local fiddle player's house. His name was Mac Snodderly. If any of you have heard Mac, he's a awesome little player. Used to play with Carroll Best a lot. So we get over to Mac's house, and I see this banjo player. And he played in a way I had never heard. I just didn't know what to make of it. He had picks on his fingers. He was picking up like a three-finger player, but he didn't sound anything like a bluegrass player that I'd ever heard. So I was impressed by that. As a clawhammer player, my playing tends to be more rhythmic and less melodic, but I was inspired by players like Carroll to try to get as many of those notes in as possible. A couple of little examples of that. One of them would be a little mountain tune that I learned as a red-haired boy, but I learned when I was older that over in Ireland they call it Little Beggar Man. But that was one of the first songs I tried to get all the notes in. Someone just play it. My son on the dulcimer over here, we're all playing my dad's instruments except for Sarah on the big fiddle. I don't think my dad had a piece of wood that big to make one of those. But Adam's been able to play with us this summer. We've really enjoyed having him back because he's been away for quite a few years. But one of the songs we like to do is one that I grew up playing, and it's a great little tune called Sally Goodman. I just don't think any instrument represents American music, true American music, better than the banjo, even though it has kind of a tortured history almost, and one that a lot of people are not aware of, but it just embodies, I think, all that's great about American music. The instrument comes over, the ancestor anyway, comes over from Africa, played by the slaves, picked up by their white neighbors, and took on in the mountains. And, you know, mountain people just never let go of it, even though it kind of fell out of fashion through much of the country. And so now it's very strongly associated with the mountains. But our African-American friends gave us this great instrument and almost certainly provided the style that I'm playing in. It's almost certainly an African-American style. I like to adapt it sometimes to different kinds of music. We play a lot of worship music, and here's one out of the hymnal that you wouldn't expect to hear on a clawhammer banjo, but hopefully I do it with adequate respect for the quality of the song. Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Seal it for thy courts above. When the Great Smoky Mountains Association, working with Dr. Michael Montgomery, authorized us to produce something
with the Great Smoky Mountains Association, Terry Maddox for overseeing the project and letting it happen, Lisa Horstman with the design work, which is beautiful on that first CD, and Kent Cave of the National Park Service, the Great Smoky Mountains National Park Service Ranger. He helped greatly with that project, was a co-producer on the project. And Dr. Michael Montgomery wrote some very lucid and wonderful notes about Joseph Sargent Hall. So that's the first of the two CDs that we're kind of celebrating inadvertently. But the second CD, of course, the main one we're focusing in on tonight, Steve Kemp and the next guest and I worked on that with Lisa Horstman doing design over the last 8 months or so. And I do want to tell you that the recordings that you will hear when you have the CD and you put it in your player, they sound differently from the original. I mean, they're the same recordings. We didn't do any doctoring or anything like that. But what we're talking about is sound engineering. This next gentleman is a wizard in the studio. And he took some recordings that, shall we say, had some years on them and brought them to a point where you can really appreciate all the great ability that Carroll Best and his fellow musicians brought into the recordings that Joseph Sargent Hall made in 56 and 59. So I would like to introduce now John Fleener, the sound engineer on both of the CDs for the Great Smoky Mountains Association. And he's the Media Collections Manager at East Tennessee State University's Archives of Appalachia. Thank you.
You may have noticed, every time you have one of these bands come out, you see all these microphones? One for the voice, one for each instrument. The recordings that were made in 56 and 59 were made on a reel-to-reel tape recorder with one microphone. The problem we had was that you have one microphone and three instruments. And everybody, they all played at barn dances and they all sounded at the same volume level. And the challenge was to bring out each instrument to where the listener could appreciate it. Where you could hear the banjo when it was his time to play, where you could hear the fiddle when it's his time to play, and the guitar a constant through the whole thing. I'd love to own that guitar. It was, I was told it was a 00018, if y'all are into Martins, out of the 50s, and it rang like a bell to the point where we had to do what they call subtractive equalization. They told me not to get technical. I don't know. Anyhow, we had to pull the overtones down because it was roaring through the entire tape. Anyhow, we have an example of the original. If you guys would play it, I'd appreciate it.
Thank you.
hear it in real good detail. And have y'all enjoyed this show tonight? I really hate to follow these musicians. I don't, you know? But it was a free show. Well, we have CDs for sale. Hey, if you want to hear the rest of it, there's CDs out front. Thank y'all.
Our next presenter will give you a demonstration of Carroll Best's banjo technique, which is very special indeed. This gentleman is Ben Bateson. He's also employed at East Tennessee State University in ETSU's well-known bluegrass, old-time, and country music program. And Ben is also a very fine studio engineer, works with students to help them produce records and that sort of thing, helps them with their recording technique, and he knows sound thoroughly. He's also a very fine banjo player, as you're about to hear. And he has kind of figured out the Carroll Best style. There are some other people who have figured that style out too, but not many on this earth, because it's such a complex and deceptively kind of, you know, people think it's melodic and sweet sounding, but it's incredibly difficult and highly rhythmic. And Ben is going to demonstrate that style for you now. Thank you, Ben.
It's great to be here tonight with all of you. And as Ted said, Carroll Best's banjo style is very intricate, and he plays a three-fingered style of banjo, which is, I believe, not a style of banjo you've heard tonight. You've heard a clawhammer style banjo, which is uses your thumb and either index or middle finger and plays only downstrokes. But Carroll played a three-fingered style of banjo that uses your thumb, index, and middle fingers, and played with finger picks to help get more volume out of the banjo. And there are other three-fingered banjo players out there. Famous like Earl Scruggs, who inspired many three-finger banjo players. Others, Ralph Stanley, Don Reno, just to name a few. And before I do a demonstration of Carroll's banjo playing, I did not have the luck to meet Carroll in person. I believe he was already gone by the time I started playing, but I did hear of Carroll Best about 10 years ago in Elkins, West Virginia, having a conversation with some other banjo players about what's called melodic style banjo, which is an attempt to play fiddle tunes note for note on the banjo in a way that other banjo players like Earl Scruggs did not. And I'm gonna play a little bit of a tune for you tonight, a tune called Cripple Creek, which is, for most three-fingered style banjo players, it's the first tune that they learn. And I'm gonna play it for you, first not the way Carroll played it, but the way Earl Scruggs played it, just to show the difference. So that's the way Earl would have played it, and this is the way Carroll would have played it, and I'll do my best to mimic Carroll as best I can.
Studied it, come away from that experience of studying Carroll's style just awed by the complexity of it, even though it's in, you know, sounds in some ways kind of direct and straightforward, it's really quite sophisticated. Our next performers are very special too, and they're here to perform a variety of material from the Southern Mountains for you. And I'll just quickly read a little bit of biographical information about each one of the three of them. Sheila K. Adams is the 2013 recipient of the nation's highest honor in traditional music. Adams was presented the NEA Fellowship Award. The multi-instrumentalist, ballad singer, and noted author grew up in Madison County and carries on the traditions of a disappearing lifestyle in the region. She has appeared in movies, soundtracks, TV, recordings, is a published author, a side-splitting storyteller, and a national treasure. Jeanette Queen is a member of the legendary Queen family. Jeanette learned to play and sing in the Queen family band in Jackson County. Daughter of the late 2007 National Heritage Award winner Mary Jane Queen and Claude Queen, she grew up one of eight children in the mountain wilds, with music ever present in the home. She carries forward seven generations of traditions learned from her mother, and she sings the songs of the mountains in her powerful, clear voice. Jeanette, thank you. And last but certainly not least, Carroll Rifkin. Joyously sharing traditional music, writing songs, exploring the role of women in mountain music, teaching dance, or engaging people to sing along, this award-winning multi-instrumentalist's soaring, sweet voice is uniquely recognizable on stage and radio. With more than 1,000 stories published in newspapers and magazines, this early member of the former Greengrass Floggers professional band team later worked solo with Tommy Jarrell, Doc Watson, and received Asheville's 2013 Bascom Lamar Lunsford Award for significant contribution to the art of Appalachian culture. So let's welcome all three of them.
Carroll Best. I have different memories of Carroll Best. It was such a nice man, and I loved the Carroll Best band. And every year I would go to the Mountain Dance and Folk Festival. This is in the late 70s, early 80s. Every year I would go, and on the wall of my office, there's a line of awards that I won at the Mountain Dance and Folk Festival, and every one of them is a second place. Second place band, second place guitar. Second place band, second place guitar, year after year. And the reason is because Carroll Best band always won first. And Carroll Best guitar player always won first. But I loved him. I was the first woman that they let place in the contest. But now Sheila.
I won first place. She won yours, actually.
Why was that?
That was because Carroll Best was one of the judges. I actually got to know Carroll when we were flying out to the West Coast to do a tour that was called the Master Hands Tour. And on that tour, Carroll was the banjo player. And so I got to see a whole different side of the quiet country gentleman that I had come to know going to Asheville and playing music at Chindig on the Green and at the Asheville Festival. And I was a little bit skittish about flying. So we were sitting there, and of course Carroll told me that he had flown all over the world when he was in the war and all this, that, and the other. And he said, now the way to look at that is, if it's your time to go, honey, then you're gonna go. So just relax into it. It's not gonna happen unless it's your time to go. I said, well, makes me feel a little bit better, Carroll. Thank you very much. He said, yep. And then kind of fell back into being the quiet gentleman that he was. And 30 seconds later, he kind of looked over at me, poked me in the ribs, and said, yeah, but what if it's a pilot's time to go? I said, dang, you could have talked all week and not said that.
I spent a lot of years backing up fiddle players and learning the tunes, and I've tried to learn the old versions, much like the ones they play on that CD, kind of not quite as slick and good as today, but we're going to play you one that's on that recording called Lost Indian, and I was not surprised because they all drank from the same well, but I asked Harville Freeman to teach it to me the way he's 82, to teach it to me the way he learned it as a child at 8 or 9, and it's almost exactly the same way that Billy Kirkpatrick plays it on that recording. So it's Lost Indian.
Thank you. Mountain Dance and Folk Festival the first couple of times I ever went, and hadn't been out there on the stage, and I was backstage practicing a little bit. Carroll Best was sitting over in the corner, and he was listening, and he said, "You go, girl." He said, "You sing." He said, "Open that mouth and sing." She can do that. I love you, Mr. Carroll.
My family fought for the South.
We're going to cheat on this song, too.
My mama said it's all right if you carry your words with you, if it's one of them real long, long, drawn-out songs. So she's smiling right now.
Oh, it's...
it's three pages. It's a history lesson.
It is a history lesson. And if you listen real close, you will find out how the states withdrew from the Union. We're on the Civil War kick. So we sang one about the boys in blue, and now we're going to sing the Bonnie Blue Flag, which is for the boys in gray, because we have to give everybody equal time. And right now I need an equal. But you'll see why I can't remember this. Well, you probably already see why I can't remember all these words. This is one that I did not learn before I was 12 years old. And it was written after 1848, so I'm not real familiar with songs that were written after 1848. That's kind of my cutoff place. And the other thing that happened was I went from being 12 years old somehow to 61, like that. So I ain't about to learn all these songs. If it bothers you, close your eyes. You don't have to look at me. We are a band of brothers native to the soil, fighting for our liberty with treasure, blood, and toil. And when our rights were threatened, the cry was near and far. Hurrah for the bonnie blue flag that flies a single star. Hurrah! Like friends and like sisters, kind were we and just. But now when northern treachery attempts our rights to mar, we hoist on high the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star. Hurrah, hurrah, the southern rights, hurrah. Hurrah for the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star. Now here comes your history lesson. That's how the states came out of the Union. First, gallant South Carolina nobly made her stand. Then came Alabama, took her by the hand. Next, quickly, Mississippi, Georgia, and Florida. All raised on high the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star. Hurrah, hurrah, for Southern rights, hurrah. Hurrah for the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star. Ye men of valor, gather round the banner of the right. Texas and Louisiana, join us in the fight. Davis, our loved president, and Stephen, statesmen are. Now rally round the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star. Hurrah, hurrah, for Southern rights, hurrah. Hurrah for the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star. Now here's to brave Virginia, the old Dominion state, with the young Confederacy at last to seal her fate. And spurred by her example, now other states prepare to hoist on high the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star. Hurrah, hurrah, for Southern rights, hurrah. Hurrah for the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star. Then cheer, boys, cheer, now raise a joyous shout. For Arkansas and North Carolina now have both gone out. And let another rousing cheer for Tennessee be given. The single star, the bonnie blue flag, has risen to 11. Hurrah, hurrah, for Southern rights, hurrah. Hurrah for the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star. Hurrah, hurrah, for Southern rights, hurrah. Hurrah for the bonnie blue flag that bears a single star.
Sing along. month.
Yep. And this was my mama's favorite hymn. It's called Build Me a Cabin in the Corner. And if you know it, then help us sing it by all means. And it's been my honor to be here in front of you nice folks tonight. Thanks for giving us a listen, and hope to see you somewhere down the road.
And ours as well.
And call us up if you have work. We're always looking for work.
We're poor. We're not just old, we're poor.
We're nice.
Said, I don't mind if I do. So he came down there that Saturday night, and I think he's there every Saturday night till I left home. But then you talk about an icon of a singer and a guitar player, that would be Mr. Raymond said, you need to give that man to him.
I play second fiddle to the banjo. This is Chelsea. She's our granddaughter. She's one of our grandsons. Columbus,
Georgia.
Georgia. Okay. This is our son. You, Carroll.
Somebody else that Carroll won't recognize is Kevin Williams. He's Kevin Williams' youngest son, and he has been very helpful with this, letting us take pictures down there at the home place, and not to caress that boy, but place they did come and start hiding stuff because I used to live there. But Kelly would put up with it. And Kelly has been so helpful during this putting this project in. And I think you need to give Kelly a hand and give all his best things.
Thank you.
fall. Walking with my guitar down these halls, dirty halls. And I knock on every door. With my songs and poems and stories in my heart. All I need is just a little start. Then I go to tear this town apart. All I want is a moment of your time. Sobbing strangers in the street, with your faces etched in patterns of defeat. Lay my many treasures at your feet. If you just give me a minute of your time, all I want is a minute of your time. The world's cloaked in white, slipping down the corridors of time. I got no time. Ah, but then again, I'm light. You have chained the greatest poet of the age in the padded darkness of little page. You won't even look at a page.
Myself. Took my cap off. I'm an Air Force person that got out of the Air Force. Jackson over here was in the Army in the war. Today is the Air Force Memorial Day of the time that this is his birthday. But the biggest part of what I want everybody here to know, this song tonight is dedicated for all our soldiers. Our soldiers. Your protection is with your military. Believe.
If it proves to be
so much material, recordings, note cards, notebooks, and so on, that he wanted to show me. And finally, in January of 1990, I was able to arrange that. He lived outside San Diego, so it's a little bit of a jump from East Tennessee. I spent the holidays with my family in Knoxville, got on the plane to San Diego. I'll say a little bit more about that experience in a minute, but during a week's conversation, Joe and I talked about so many, many different subjects, personal, professional, reminiscences of our own experiences of the national park and people in the Smoky Mountain area. Joe at that time was in his 80s. He had struggled with some major health crises. He knew that he didn't have very long. And I asked Joe point blank, what was he planning to do with all of his material? And he said, frankly, he didn't know. The Library of Congress had a copy of most of what he had, but all that was in his house, which was everywhere, he really didn't know what he was going to do with it. He didn't have the strength to organize something for publication, and he didn't have any long-range plans for publication. So he said, rather pessimistically, I'd have to say, well, I think I'll just give these materials here to an archive and hope that someday a researcher or researchers will find my material either in the Library of Congress or wherever else it's deposited. What a prediction. In 2004, I had co-edited a dictionary of Smoky Mountain English with Joe Hall. Shortly thereafter, seeds were planted for the Old Time Smoky Mountain Music CD, which came out in 2010. And now the CD of 2014, emerging from Joseph Hall's collections. Ladies and gentlemen, I think somebody has found Joseph Hall's material. Wouldn't you agree? Now, if Joseph Hall were here tonight, I'm not quite sure what he would say. I would think, however, that he wouldn't say much. During my week of visiting Joe Hall, he came across to me as one of the shyest, most unassuming people I had ever met, particularly in academia. He didn't wear his Columbia University, yes, Ivy League, you know. He had a Columbia University PhD. He didn't wear that on his shoulder. He was a very self-effacing individual, unself-promoting. And I'm not sure that he would have done much more than just smile in enjoyment at the music tonight. And I will tell you this, he had a Jimmy Carter smile. You know what I mean? You can see, you can recognize Jimmy Carter by his smile, can't you? He spent more than 50 years of his life as someone who studied the Smoky Mountains. Beginning in 1937, he had a summer job in the Smokies. He became, shall we say, intrigued, in fact, fascinated by the people there. He loved to go just hang out with mountain people, particularly in the CCC camps. There were young men about his age, and loved to hike and roam in the mountains, and he enjoyed their fellowship greatly. What Joseph Hall did in documenting the Smokies and recording music from the Smokies was, I think, this is my interpretation, his effort to pay back the people for their generosity to him, for their open doors, their open hearts, their meals, their kinship, their willingness to take him as he was, and he took them as they were. And he wanted to present mountain people exactly to the world as they wanted to be. So when it came to recording, it didn't hurt that he was from Hollywood. When it came to recording, most of the recordings in the early days, 1939, were by young men who were learning Carter family songs and other songs and wanting Joe to take these things back, these recordings back to Hollywood and play them for someone in the radio industry. That wasn't going to pass, but the point there to make is that Joe Hall wanted mountain people to express themselves without the recorder, the scholar, or anybody else imposing an interpretation, just looking for certain kinds of songs, trying to find a community like the one in Songcatcher, where everybody knew hundreds of ballads and sang them all day long. He just turned on the machine and let people say what they wanted to say and sing what they wanted to sing. He was a collector. He was an organizer. And most people in academia who collect never leave their collection in a state that is organized enough to do much with. But Joseph Hall's 50-year collection is so detailed that when you read his notes and when you read about his music, you feel like you are there with the person who left those memories, those sentiments, and those stories behind. He was the most remarkably scrupulous investigator I have ever known in the notes that he took on people. And I say that with some experience, because the dictionary we published in 2004 is a dictionary of 700 pages. It has citations from over 250 people that Joseph Hall interviewed or overheard. He always had his notebook ready to write things down, often without notice, and they appeared in his notes. And for that reason, there are so many names in the Hall material. If you do family history and you have ancestors three generations ago in the Smoky Mountain area, your ancestor might very well be quoted in that dictionary. Joseph Hall will continue to contribute because of its extraordinary organization and the detailed documentation that people can follow and people can take as trustworthy. I'll just mention in closing two things where you can find evidence of that. One of them is in the aforementioned dictionary, the Dictionary of Smoky Mountain English 2004. It's been out of print for several years, unfortunately, but I am on the verge of submitting a much expanded second edition to the University of Tennessee Press save your money for Christmas of next year, folks, because it will be a book that people will not put down on Christmas Day. They will get lost in it because of the lure of mountain language, and it really is interesting. The other thing that I can mention is a website that a student of mine and I have set up at the University of South Carolina. We're about to change the name of it, so don't be put off. This is what it's going to look like. There is a revolving picture at the top. If you just Google for Appalachian English, you will find this website. There are about 20 speakers that he recorded in 1939, presently found there. And I think within the next month or so, we're going to have 60 speakers. On the back of this little flyer, and there's a stack of them at the Great Smoky Mountain Association table, you'll find a list of about 60 people Joseph Hall interviewed in 1939. Some of them were born as early as the 1840s. That's pretty remarkable to hear somebody from the 1840s telling a bear story. But it's at this website. And I've indicated here what county people are from. There are about 12 or 15 from Haywood County. And so if you're interested in family history, you might want to check your internet, find this site, and look for the upgrade, which will be coming along very shortly. So pick up one of these flyers with the revolving pictures of the Smokies. There's a lot more at this website on mountain speech, and it will continue to grow in the years ahead. It's just one of those things that, in his own way, Joseph Hall dreamed about, but in an equally true way, it is a natural outgrowth of the generosity of mountain people sharing with him. And he felt it was his responsibility to share them with the rest of the world and to have them speak and sing for themselves. So let's get back to the music.